ओके, सो दिस लेक्चर विल बी द लेक्चर नंबर 3 इन एंजाइम रेगुलेटरी स्ट्रेटजीज. दिस इज द यूजुअल डिस्क्लेमर दैट इट इज मेंट फॉर यू एंड इट शुड नॉट बी यूज्ड फॉर एनी अदर पर्पस, कॉपीड और पोस्टेड ऑन एनी साइट विदाउट माय परमिशन. एंड सम ऑफ द पिक्चर्स और डायग्राम्स इन द प्रेजेंटेशन हैव बीन टेकन फ्रॉम पब्लिक डोमेन वेबसाइट्स, पॉपुलर बुक्स टू मेक द टॉपिक ईजी टू अंडरस्टैंड. द क्रेडिट फॉर सच पिक्चर्स रिमेन्स विद द ओरिजिनल पब्लिशर. ओके, so the third strategy is regulation by cyclic AMP. So what is cyclic AMP? In the first place, cyclic AMP, you will be studying in second semester, it is a major intracellular or secondary messenger. So there are different types of secondary messengers in the cell, in eukaryotic cell, for helping, for mediating the action of proteinaceous hormones. And cyclic AMP is one of the major intracellular secondary messengers. And how it is formed? It is formed from ATP by the action of enzyme adenylate cyclase. So you have ATP, and in presence of adenylate cyclase, it gets converted into cyclic AMP. So this is the structure of ATP. This is ribose sugar. This is adenine, and there are three phosphates. This is alpha phosphate. This is beta phosphate. This is gamma phosphate. So adenosine triphosphate. So these three triphosphates are attached to carbon number 5 of the ribose. This is carbon number 5. Here, okay. So this is alpha, beta, and gamma. And in presence of adenylate cyclase, if pyrophosphate group is removed, and a cyclic 3,5 monophosphate. This is carbon 5, and this is carbon number 3. Cyclic 3,5 monophosphate. It is also called as cyclic AMP. So it is formed. The action of cyclic AMP is mediated by protein kinase. So there are different types of protein kinases in the cell. Okay, in the last lecture also we have come across one protein kinase. So this protein kinase is specific, it mediates the action of cyclic AMP. It is called as protein kinase A, or in short it is also known as PKA. It is also known as cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. Cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. Now this protein kinase A, it is made up of two catalytic subunits, each is around 38 kilodalton. Two catalytic subunits, each is 38 kilodalton, and there are two regulatory subunits, each is 49 kilodaltons. Okay, and each regulatory subunit in turn has two binding sites for cyclic AMP. So cyclic AMP is a modulator, so the binding sites are different than the catalytic site. They are located on the regulatory subunit. So there are two binding sites for cyclic AMP per regulatory subunit. The active site is located on the catalytic subunit, as I just told you. The binding of cyclic AMP to regulatory subunits cause them to dissociate from the catalytic subunit. So these two subunits are joined, they are associated. But when cyclic AMP comes and binds to regulatory subunits, so it causes a conformational change and it makes regulatory subunits dissociate themselves from the catalytic subunits. So two types of subunits are separated. The separated catalytic subunits are active. When the catalytic subunits are associated with regulatory subunit, the whole enzyme is inactive. But catalytic subunits, when they're separated from the regulatory subunit, they become active. And what do? They catalyze the phosphorylation of target proteins. So the action remains the same. What do they do? They catalyze the phosphorylation of the target protein. And what is the site? The site of phosphorylation is again the same, serine specific or threonine residues. Specific serine or specific threonine residues. Even a small amount of cyclic AMP, means as much as less as 10 nanogram, is sufficient to activate protein kinase A. Okay. Very small amount of cyclic AMP can trigger this particular action. 10 nanogram. Okay, 1 milligram is 1000 microgram and 1 microgram is 1000 nanogram. So very small amount can trigger this particular activity, and the signal gets amplified because of a cascade. Means you have a PKA which is inactive. So in presence of cyclic AMP, it gets active. Okay, means active means what? The two types of subunit dissociate, the regulatory subunit dissociate themselves from the catalytic subunit and it becomes active. And what does it do? Once it becomes active, it is capable of phosphorylating the target protein. The site of phosphorylation is specific serine / threonine residues. Not any serine, not any threonine, only specific serine which is presented in a particular sequence, in a particular consensus motif we have seen in the last lecture, and I'll be talking in the next slide also. And that threonine or that serine only is the site of phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. So how does it happen? So it happens because the regulatory subunits have a pseudo-substrate sequence. Regulatory subunits have a pseudo-substrate sequence. The sequence is arginine, arginine, glycine, alanine, isoleucine. Okay, this is pseudo-substrate because it matches with the true substrate sequence, the true consensus motif identified for phosphorylation by protein kinase A. And what is that? We have seen it in the last lecture also, and this lecture also I am saying. It is arginine, arginine, X. X is an amino acid with a small chain, glycine. Serine / threonine, Y or Z, which is an amino acid with a hydrophobic side chain, R group, for example, isoleucine. Okay, so this is the true consensus motif identified by the protein kinase A. And the regulatory subunit has a sequence which is similar to this. And therefore, we are calling it as a pseudo-substrate sequence. See the similarity. There is an arginine, there is an arginine, there is a glycine. But in place of serine threonine, it has got a glycine. And there is an isoleucine. Okay, so catalytic subunit identifies it, recognizes it as a true substrate sequence. And therefore, it remains, it gets bound over there. And the two types of subunits remain associated. Okay, actually it is not the true substrate sequence, but because of very strong similarity, catalytic subunit identifies it as a true substrate sequence, and it gets bound over there. Had it been a true substrate sequence, it would have been processed. Means it would have been processed means it would have undergone phosphorylation. But since it is not a true substrate sequence, there is no serine, there is no threonine, so it remains attached over there, no phosphorylation takes place. So pseudo-substrate sequence occupies the catalytic subunit, preventing the entry of true substrate sequence, proteins for phosphorylation. Proteins having true substrate sequence, they are prevented from entering the catalytic site because that catalytic site is occupied by the regulatory subunits having the pseudo-substrate sequence. Now, binding of cyclic AMP to the regulatory subunit causes what? Causes a conformational change. And as a result of that, the regulatory subunit moves out from the catalytic site. The pseudo-substrate sequence moves out from the catalytic site. The catalytic units are now free to bind to the target protein. So if you have to see it like this, so you have two regulatory subunits. This is the complete enzyme, protein kinase A, R2C2. In presence of cyclic AMP, it binds to regulatory subunit, okay, and causing them to dissociate from the catalytic subunit. So what do you have? You have two regulatory subunits and you have two catalytic subunits separated. And these separated catalytic subunits are active. And pictorially, if you have to see, it looks like this. So you have two catalytic subunits, the one in blue. This is the active site. These are the regulatory subunit in yellow. And each one has two binding sites for cyclic AMP. This one, this one, this one, and this one, right? And there is a pseudo-substrate sequence, a sequence which is similar to the true substrate sequence, the consensus motif identified by the pKa, this one. As a result of that, it goes and occupy the catalytic site. Okay, but since it is not a true substrate sequence, no further action takes place. Further action is what? Phosphorylation. Okay, it doesn't take place because it is a pseudo-substrate sequence. So in presence of four molecules of cyclic AMP, they will bind two each to two regulatory subunits, cause a conformational change. You see a change in the shape, right? Cyclic AMP is bound and there is a change in the conformation. And as a result of that, the pseudo-substrate sequence, it gets moved from the catalytic site. These sites are free now. So these free catalytic subunits are active. Target protein will come and bind. Target proteins with this kind of consensus sequence will come and bind, and the specific serine / threonine in this consensus motif will get phosphorylated by the catalytic subunit. So this is important. This comes into the examination, the mechanism. Now the next type of regulatory strategy is zymogen activation. So some of the enzymes are synthesized as inactive precursors. When they are synthesized, they are inactive, and they are also called as proenzyme or zymogens. And they are converted later on to their active form by specific proteolytic cleavage. Understand proteolytic cleavage, because they are proteins. So a specific proteolytic cleavage means digestion of a specific peptide bond, you know, converts those inactive precursor into their corresponding active form. Unlike the other form of regulation, this takes place only once in the lifetime. This is irreversible. Means once an inactive precursor has been converted to active, the active one cannot be converted back to inactive. So this takes place only once in the lifetime of the enzyme. The inactive precursor synthesized in the inactive form gets converted to active form by specific proteolytic cleavage. Okay. The other strategies, for example, covalent modification, allosteric regulation, they are reversible. Covalent modification can take place multiple times. An inactive enzyme can be converted to active, and when there is no need, that active can be converted back to its inactive form. Another characteristic feature of zymogen activation is that it can take place extracellularly. Within the cell, not necessary. It can take place outside the cell also, and therefore, as there is no ATP is required. Because in case of covalent modification, we have seen, it can take place only within the cell because ATP is required. Here, there is no requirement of ATP, therefore, it can take place outside the cell also. Activation of enzyme by irreversible proteolysis is quite common in biological system. For example, digestive enzyme. Digestive enzyme in particular, all of them are synthesized in their corresponding inactive precursor forms, and later on, they're converted to their active form. As I said, it takes place only once in the lifetime. Once an inactive enzyme has been converted to its corresponding active, you know, it cannot be converted back to its active form. For example, in stomach, pepsinogen is the zymogen, or at the site of synthesis stomach, it is synthesized as inactive precursor pepsinogen, and the active form is pepsin. The trypsinogen, it is synthesized in pancreas. It is also a protease. It is inactive zymogen, and it gets converted by proteolytic cleavage to trypsin. Chymotrypsinogen, it is also synthesized in pancreas, and its active conformation, active enzyme is chymotrypsin. Similarly, hormone insulin, it is a protein hormone. It is also synthesized as proinsulin. Blood clotting factors, their blood clotting is also mediated by a series of zymogen activation. The point is that this kind of regulation by proteolytic cleavage, irreversible, you know, it is quite common in biological system. Some hormones are activated like this. Blood clotting is mediated by a series of zymogen activation, and lots of digestive enzymes are, you know, activated by this particular mechanism. Switch off the audio. Now let's see activation of digestive enzyme chymotrypsinogen. So please switch off the audio. Chymotrypsin, it is a proteolytic enzyme. It is synthesized in the acinar cells of pancreas as inactive precursor chymotrypsinogen. And what does it do? It hydrolyzes protein. It digests protein in small intestine. It is synthesized as a single polypeptide of 245 amino acids. Devoid of any enzymatic activity. So it is synthesized as its inactive form of 245 amino acid long polypeptide chain. Okay, and it doesn't have any catalytic activity. It is converted to its active form when peptide bond between arginine 15, amino acid arginine at position number 15, and amino acid isoleucine at position number 16, that bond is hydrolyzed by enzyme trypsin. Then it gets converted to its active form. Two more dipeptides, and what are they? 14, 15, and 147, 148. They are also removed in subsequent step to produce alpha chymotrypsin, which is stable and active form of the enzyme. So there are two rounds of proteolysis. In round one, A peptide bond between arginine 15 and arginine 16 is hydrolyzed. And in round 2, two dipeptides, amino acid number 1415 and amino acid number 147, 148 are removed, giving a very stable alpha chymotrypsin. See, it is shown over here. So you have chymotrypsin, single polypeptide, 245 amino acid. In presence of trypsin, what happens? A peptide bond, a specific peptide bond between arginine 15 and arginine isoleucine 16, it is hydrolyzed. Okay, so resulting chymotrypsin is called as pi chymotrypsin. It is also active, but it is not stable. It has the same enzyme activity as alpha chymotrypsin, but it is not very stable. Then in a second round of hydrolysis, two dipeptides, serine 14 and arginine 15, these two amino acids, they are removed, and threonine 147 and asparagine 148. Threonine 147 and asparagine 148, they are also removed. So 14, 15, 147, 148, these two amino acids are freed, and you get three fragments which are joined by interchain disulfide bridges. Like this. Interchain disulfide bridges. Right? So these are called as interchain disulfide bridges. The three fragments are held together by interchain disulfide bridges. And this resulting enzyme is alpha chymotrypsin, which is active, but it is stable also. It is active and stable also. So this is how inactive chymotrypsinogen gets converted to chymotrypsin. Similarly, we'll see one more example, activation of trypsinogen. So trypsinogen is also a proteolytic enzyme, and it is synthesized by the, it is synthesized as inactive precursor. Trypsin is synthesized as inactive precursor, trypsinogen. It is converted to its active form by proteolytic cleavage of a hexapeptide from N-terminus. Hexapeptide means a peptide which is made up of six amino acids from the N-terminus. It is cleaved by the action of a specific enzyme called enteropeptidase. Enteropeptidase is present in the duodenum. Stomach ke niche. Duodenum mein enteropeptidase enzyme hoga. It will cleave an hexapeptide from the trypsinogen. Okay. And how does it do it? It cleaves a specific, very unique lysine isoleucine bond. This lysine isoleucine bond, this is the N-terminus. So six amino acid from the N-terminus, hexapeptide will be removed by cleaving a bond between lysine and isoleucine. Okay, and it is catalyzed by enteropeptidase. So it will, this hexapeptide composition is given over here. N-terminus amino acid is valine, followed by 4 aspartic acid, and the 6th amino acid is lysine, this. So the bond between lysine and isoleucine is broken. The 7th amino acid isoleucine becomes the 1st amino acid of the trypsin. And this trypsin is now active. It is synthesized as trypsinogen, which is inactive. So these two examples are of zymogen activation. So thank you very much.